Assalamu alaikum. We're here in Nottingham on Sunday the 7th of December. We're here to meet Sidi Baraka Blue, who is performing tonight at the New Art Exchange. And we are sisters in the community and we have some questions for him. And an answer session.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
How are you doing?
Very good.
I've got a question for you.
Yes, ask away.
How were you accepted as a white weaver in your community?
I was, as a white convert, weaver, alhamdulillah, I think I was, when I first came to Islam, I took my shahada at a mosque. The first time I ever entered into a mosque, it was a Friday Jumu'ah, and I came to take my shahada after prayer. And as you know, we've all probably witnessed this a million times if we didn't experience it ourselves. Like a brother or sister wants to take their shahada after Jumu'ah, and everyone's like, oh, okay. And so went up there and repeated after the Imam. And afterwards, everyone, all the brothers lined up to hug me and, you know, kiss me on my cheek and that cheek and then that cheek again. And, you know, it's all like, oh, I don't know the cultural cues. But to be honest, I was just overwhelmed by all the love. Like, this is intense. Like, many of my family members never even hugged me, kissed me like this. What is this? I don't even know you people.
Yeah.
So, alhamdulillah.
What brought you to Islam?
Yeah.
I was first exposed to Islam by, I guess you could say, two currents. One current was hip-hop music, rap music. And growing up in urban America in the 90s, that's what was going on. That's what was cool. So, you know, it's funny because I think in the mainstream culture, and especially outside of America, people see hip-hop rap as like a negative influence, right? And I'm not saying it was all positive on me. But if you dig deeper, you see that many of the founding individuals involved in hip-hop from the very beginning have been Muslim. From Africa Bambaataa, who was like kind of basically the godfather of hip-hop and names his son T.C. Islam, and the Zulu Nation really on the principles of Islam, and really a lot carrying over from the Nation of Islam and the kind of proto-Islamic black Muslim movements. And so when I was in high school, which you guys call college, right?
Yeah.
I was, what, 14, 15? And I was really into hip-hop, making my own music as well, and the whole thing. And, you know, in Public Enemy videos, they have Malcolm X posters, and I heard about Malcolm X, and a lot of old records, they sample Malcolm X's speeches in the record. So, you know, people jokingly say that Malcolm X is the patron saint of hip-hop, you know? And but I didn't really know that much about Malcolm X when I was 14 or 15, but I remember my girlfriend at the time, my high school girlfriend, she went to a different school than me, and she had to read the autobiography of Malcolm X for class. And so I saw the book on her bookshelf, and I was like, hey, can I borrow that? She was like, yeah, sure. And the only reason I wanted to know who Malcolm X was, because I was like, he's important to all these rappers that I look up to. Mm-hmm. And so I need to know who he is. I'm embarrassed. I don't know who he is, right? And so reading that book was very transformative for me because I was at an age where I was exposed, you know, when high school, college, you first get exposed to drugs and the street life and all these things. And I knew people that were in gangs and I knew people that were criminals. And I knew, you know, I wasn't too heavy into that world, but it was all around me.
It's around.
And, you know, you're going through that, like, oh, the adults don't understand and they're not cool. And so you're the kind of rebellious phase. And Malcolm's autobiography was so powerful to me because, you know, for those of you who know his story, he's someone who came from the streets, was a criminal, you know, was a thief, was using drugs, was in prison. And so he speaks about that experience, and it was like, it reminded me of the music I was listening to and some of the people that I knew and some of the world that I was, you know, exposed to. And so, you know, I think for most kids, they don't like reading because it's boring, it's not relevant to them. They don't like, you know what I mean? And the brother asked me on the way here, he's like, how'd you get into poetry? And I can't be like, well, because of Shakespeare or
because of rapping.
It was because of Tupac.
Yeah.
Like, that's who I wanted to be like.
You're a master many men.
It's not that I wanted to be like Shakespeare. That stuff was boring to me. But as I grew older, now I appreciate Shakespeare. Now I see that he's a master of the language, but it took Tupac to allow me to appreciate that.
To get you there.
So anyway, so there was the hip hop through Malcolm. So through that, I had a deep respect for Islam. And I saw that, you know, Islam was something that was about justice and standing for the oppressed and, you know, these type of things, the downtrodden. And then at the same time, so that was kind of the kind of urban black experience that was becoming kind of pop culture in America. So through that, I was exposed. And then the kind of counterculture white experience in America, which is that my parents' generation, the 60s and 70s, they came through the kind of cultural revolution, the whole beat generation and the hippies and the whole thing, West Coast liberal. And so I jokingly say, because I'm sure you get this all the time, but people just assume, oh, mashallah, you converted to Islam from a Christian background. And I'm like, well, actually, I never really went to church. My family was what we know in Europe and America is common is kind of post-Christian.
Yeah.
You know, maybe go to church once or twice a year, maybe not, but really it's very secular. But at the same time, my parents, you know, they always taught me that there's beauty and there's good in all traditions and kind of the golden rule, and at the core of it, it's all the same. So it wasn't anti-religion by any means. But God and religion just wasn't something that was talked about, which is becoming more and more common in kind of Europe and in America, for better or worse. So I jokingly say, but it's true, is like in the homes of my family and my friends' families, it was easier to find the books of the Dalai Lama or the poetry of Rumi than it was to find a Bible.
Yeah.
Right? You know, you see that people that this kind of openness to spirituality, but not really interested in the kind of rules and rituals of religion, just treat everyone good and okay, you know, that type of thing. So I was exposed through some of my friends. One of my best friend's father was a poet himself, and he had this library full of Rumi, and so I was exposed to that very young. It's because through hip hop, I was interested in language, and I love poetry and the power of words, and I was getting exposed to that, and so I started to read Rumi and Hafiz and some of the Persian Sufi poets, and immediately it was like I realized there was something deeper going on. It wasn't just that they're good with language. I love language and alliteration and the power of metaphor and all these things, but it wasn't just that, oh, these are the best, you know, wordsmiths that I've ever read, but it was that they're talking about something deeper. And what are they getting at? And I could tell that it wasn't so much their words, it was the state that they were speaking from. That their words were almost kind of just pouring forth out of them from this spiritual reality that they were in. And so because of that, I wanted to dive deeper. So this is the kind of long version. But again, I didn't immediately say, I'm going to become Muslim. I was really of the kind of, what's the point of organized religion? I kind of make my own path, take a little from Buddhism, take a little from Islam, take a little from Christianity, take a little from Hinduism, take a little from ancient Egyptian religion. That was cool. I was interested in that. Take a little from just and mash it up and make my own thing. I didn't really see the point of all the rituals and stuff, which now I see. I came to appreciate that later. So what happened is when I was about 19, 20, a few of my friends converted to Islam. And one of them, he was from a Sicilian background. And he was really into Sicilian history. He was really into mafia and the whole thing, right? But as he got into it, he realized that Sicily was a Muslim island for, at the same time that Spain was Muslim, for hundreds of years. And if you look at Sicilian people, you can see they have the kind of North African look, you know, and Southern Italian people as well. So he was like, wow, my ancestors are Muslim. So he got really interested in reading about that. And he ended up converting to Islam. And so that put it just in my consciousness that it's something you can do. And a few of my other friends around that time did. But again, I wasn't like, you know, I even prayed with them a few times, but it wasn't like I need to become Muslim. But really what it was is I kind of hit a period of, I guess you could say, emptiness in my life. You know, I realized that I had been caught up in some things that I was, you could say, less than proud of, and I was exposed to, you know, drugs and kind of the street. And I realized that I was developing some self-destructive behaviors, and I had a falling out with some of my close friends because of these kind of, just the life we were living and the self-destructive patterns. And it really caused me to have a moment of introspection, and I realized that, and I kind of got myself into a situation that I couldn't get myself out of, and I, you know, it's easy when you're kind of smooth sailing to just feel like you're on top of the world, but when you hit that rock bottom and you have one of those moments where you realize
things force you don't know to look at yourself.
Exactly. Sometimes. Where you realize I can't actually help myself. Mm. That I've tried everything. And it's like, you know, a man who's in a storm on a ship and you're sailing and the storm is huge and the waves are bigger than the ship and you feel like you're trying to attack and you're trying to switch course and you feel like, okay, I got this. But the moment where you realize that huge wave is coming and there's nothing you can do, and at that moment you just say, dear God. In whatever language you know, you just say, there's nothing I can do. So you give it up. And that's when I had a moment like that, and I prayed my first sincere prayer, because those are the sincere moments. A lot of times when we pray, we still see ourselves, we still think we have power, but when you realize your utter need upon something which transcends yourself, that is when you truly pray, without ascribing any power to yourself, in total need. And I didn't know what I was praying for was Islam, really, but in that moment, I feel that for sure, I know with certainty that my prayer was answered, and through a strange circumstance of events, you know, basically 6 months later, I was there in that mosque, being embraced by all these strange men who I never knew, and embracing the path of Islam. So, alhamdulillah. That was about 10 years
ago. Have you ever lost faith?
Have I ever lost faith? I can say with gratitude that I've never lost faith in the One, the Most High, the Supreme, the God, Allah, Yahweh, Jah, whatever, you know, the ultimate reality. I always had an intuitive knowledge from childhood in that. So in that, no. But I will say there are moments where I've
we got to a point where you've questioned.
I've never questioned whether Islam. You see, the thing is like when I read about Islam, it wasn't actually that I had to change much. I always believed in a one supreme divinity that we are all from and that we all return to, that created us, and that at the core of our being, we all have a mysterious and profound connection directly to that being, that creator. And I always believed in the wisdom from all the traditions. I never had a problem, you know, basically I always believed in Jesus, but I never believed he was God. I always believed he was a wise man who his message had been corrupted. It was clear to me that what now passes for Christianity is a far cry from the path of Jesus, peace be upon him. And I always had deep respect for the Buddha and Lao Tzu, you know, in Taoism and all traditions. I looked at them really because I wasn't raised with religion, so I was able to look at them, you know, just like the human history, all as one collective human history. And so I had no doubt, no problem accepting that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one of these great masters. who came. And so in that sense, the greater principles of Islam, I never have had an issue with. But there are some of the, what was presented to me as Islam, and some of the rules, and some of the practices, and some of the way it was presented, that I was like, that doesn't necessarily sit well with me. That doesn't feel right with me. And interestingly enough, when I had the opportunity to study or to sit with people of true discernment or true prophetic inheritance, some of the great scholars, or when I was able to study myself and dig deeper, I found that none of those issues that I felt a way about were actually, you could say, indisputable parts of the deen. There were always things that there were actually differences of opinion.
Yeah.
So I remember the first time, for instance, when somebody told me music was haram. And I was a brand new Muslim, and I was obviously from a musical background. And I was actually in Morocco, and I'd only been Muslim like 3 months, but I was kind of like a, you know, gung-ho dervish. I was like, I bought a ticket, all the money I have, had a backpack, I'm going to the Muslim world. And I knew a friend from the mosque in Seattle where I converted. His family, he was Moroccan, so he's like, you can go stay with my family. So it's like, first Ramadan. And one of them told me music was haram. And I went in the room and I kind of like sat there and I was like, this can't be true, this can't be right. You know, I knew nothing. I was like so innocent and ignorant. But, I basically, as I studied, found that it's far more nuanced and there's much ikhtilaf. And Islam is a religion that music has played a central part in most Muslim cultures. And the guitar was introduced into the West through Muslim Spain, and Islam spread through India. You know, the vast majority of Muslims here are Asian, right? The Islam spread through the subcontinent through Qawwali music, right? And through Black Africa, through music, and through, you know, all of these lands. Through. So, okay, check that one off. Okay, that didn't really feel right to me. And then other things, you know, whether it's hyper strict gender relations, or whether it's other things that I didn't necessarily seem to be necessary for a healthy and beautiful practice of Islam. I was blessed enough to be exposed early on to scholars who were very knowledgeable and very aware of the Western culture. Many of them converts themselves who had been overseas for decades, and who came back and who could be like, just take it easy. That's not a big deal. Or go ahead, do your music, and it's good that you do the music and things of that nature. So, alhamdulillah, I would say that I was blessed in that I always had people that I feel were true inheritors of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so what I could say is I never lost faith in Allah or His divine messengers, peace be upon them all, or in the practice of Islam, the path of Islam and its transformative effect, because it transformed me and I saw the effects of it in myself and in people that I was able to sit with. But I did question, how am I going to navigate certain Muslim communities, and, you know, do I even really want to be around Muslims sometimes? Like, maybe it's just better if I'm by myself or with my family or some of my close friends from before Islam. You know, I feel maybe more even in a sacred space around them than some of the dynamics and some of the issues and some of the imbalances and some of the sicknesses that are prevalent in Muslim communities, but also in all communities, I mean. So I think that's what I would say is, yeah, how do I navigate this as a convert? Because as much as this religion, and I would venture to guess that everyone here who converted to Islam, one of the strongest reasons, every convert I've talked to, is the emphasis on, it's just you and God. This no intermediary, this idea that the Allah is closer to you than the vein in your neck, and that, you know, He hears your innermost thoughts and that which is more hidden, and it's this profound connection. As much as that is true, and as much as we all will stand on the day of rising and be called to account alone for our own actions and won't be called to account for the actions of others. At the same time, Islam is very much a communal religion. It's about community, and it's emphasized that we're a ummah, that we're together, we're a family. And so that's a harder piece to balance, especially if you don't find a community that's supportive, that is loving, that is nurturing, that allows you to feel welcomed and to feel that you can come in your imperfect state and be supported as you work through the issues that we all have. So that's what I would say as far as my only doubts or my only issues was how to navigate
that. Yeah, because when you're learning about Islam and you're a revert, it's really difficult sometimes to be accepted within what I would say a traditional Muslim community.
Yeah.
Because you feel silly sometimes, you know, asking questions about, because you've made that crossover, haven't you, from a normal perspective, you know, what we would say was normal, the kind of Western perspective,
dominant,
to a really, I don't know, you kind of change, you almost reinvent yourself, don't you, because you're changing your morals, your values, your principles, everything has to change to a certain extent. So, you know, you might meet a principled person and they'll say, oh, well, I'm really principled, I don't agree with that. And I'll think, well, I've actually had to change my principles to become who I am.
Especially for older people who, people who were at a more mature age,
we find that you've actually done all the what you can do, what you can't do.
Right.
You think you've found yourself. So you're at a stage in life where, well, I've spent all these years, I know who I am now, I'm comfortable in my own skin. You've already been gone through the, you can't do this, can't do that, growing up with your parents,
sure,
and then you come into a faith and it's all of a sudden, you're not actually that person, and you can't do this, and you can't do that either. And so it becomes a question of, what a lot of the sisters are saying is, where do I go with it? Who do I turn to? And how do, yes, we turn to Allah, we know that we turn to Allah with all of our problems, but who can understand that I'm at this stage in my life and I feel comfortable with myself and you're telling me that that's not the way to be?
Sure.
I can't, especially when you mentioned music, for example, you know, so I can't listen to music and I can't dress like that and I can't socialise, I can't go to a family wedding, I can't go to a christening. And it's like all of a sudden your head just goes berserk with it.
I stopped going to the recording studio. So I completely backed off from my music and that's my passion. Kind of hearing that, I'm slowly getting back into my music.
Yeah, I mean, subhanAllah. I mean, see, here's the problem, is that what you say is true. The point of taking the path of Islam is to be transformed. Nobody wants to stay the same. I mean, the whole point is that the whole religion is about this alchemical process of changing the base metal of the lower self through the remembrance of God and through the prayer and the fasting and through community and through all these acts of worship, that you become a heart of gold, someone who's transformed, illuminated, enlightened. But the thing is that for many people who converted, you know, in the recent period, there's not a model for how to do that as a British woman, as an American man, who is, because the reality is, for most people who come from an immigrant background, predominantly Asian here, their Islam is inseparable from their culture. They can't, right? It's as if, like, if you don't eat biryani for sahur, your fast isn't going to be accepted, right?
She's got the same sense of humor as us, sorry.
You okay?
Well, that's the first thing I normally do. Are you okay? But then burst out laughing.
Right? It's as if you don't eat biryani for sahur, then your fast won't be accepted, right? Of course, you know, and the first thing is like, you convert to Islam, okay, dress them in a salwar kameez and, you know, yes, feed them curry, and you know what I mean, learn the thing. There's nothing wrong with that. I love curry. And I love biryani. But I also love fish and chips.
Yes.
For everyone that, you know, I mean, the point is there's nothing wrong with it. And Islam is a beautiful path that is a universal way of life for all human beings in all cultural contexts at all periods of time until the end of this cycle of the world. And so if you look, you know, in Black Africa, and if you look in Turkey, and if you look in Southeast Asia, or you look in, you know, Morocco, or you look in Egypt, all of these are very different culturally. Very different culturally, but the prayers are the same. The prostration is the same. The fasting is the same. The greeting is the same. The dress is different, but the important part is what is covered, what is, that the human frame is ennobled, that you are, you know, that you're representing yourself as a representative of the divine on earth, and these type of things. But so, you know, one of my teachers said, Islam is prostrating in prayer. But culture is what the carpet you prostrate looks like and what type of head covering the individual who's prostrating is wearing. And it's not, it is a disease. And it's a veil that some people have that they think all Muslims have to dress the same, all Muslims have to. I mean, so Islam is dynamic. And always it said there's certain things about culture that we accept, there's certain things about culture that we reject, and there's certain things about culture that we transform. And you see it from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What do we, when we say it's the sunnah of the Prophet to wear a turban, it's true. But all men of his time wore turbans. It was a practice of the Arabs. The pre-Islamic Arabs, all the Arabs that were opposing the Sahaba and trying to kill them were wearing turbans. But it's a practice that the Prophet ﷺ did, and so it's something that the Muslims adopted, and it was transformed to be something that ennobles the human being and something that is a prophetic sunnah. So it's beautiful. I love to wear the imamah, the turban. Also the miswak, the tooth stick. This was something, this was their toothbrush that the people of his era used. Right? So, but it became a prophetic sunnah because he encouraged his companions to do it all the time because cleanliness and purity were an encouragement. So we honor the tooth stick, and even though we have toothbrush and Colgate and all the things, people still like to use it because they love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's good. But that is
an miswak toothpaste.
Yes, I have some. It's very good. It tastes great, huh?
You have to have this.
Exactly. But the idea is that there's certain things that were accepted and certain things that were transformed. There's certain things that the Prophet rejected from his community.
Sorry, I don't know how to put on silent on a normal.
It's all good. There's certain things that the Prophet ﷺ rejected from his companion, from his time period. You know, it was common for the Arabs to drink a lot. That's forbidden. It was common for them to, out of shame, bury their daughters. That was forbidden, right? There's certain things that were rejected that are cultural practices. And there's certain things that were transformed because it was very important for the Arabs' poetry, right? And a lot of the Jahiliyyah pre-Islamic poetry, if you translate it into like urban slang, it sounds exactly like rap music. Right, one of the famous Jahiliya poems, it goes, oh, you think you're ignorant? I dare you to try to get ignorant with us. If you get ignorant with us, we'll get so ignorant that you'll realize you have no idea what ignorance even is. Right, because it was like, it was this same idea, like, we're tough, we'll cut your head off, we'll kill whoever, we're not afraid, we're not backing down, this is our turf, this is our tribe, we're generous, the wine is flowing with us, we're, you know, in the club popping bottles, basically, is and generosity, look how much money we spend, look how many camels we have, you know, wasn't Mercedes now, but then it was camels. So it's the exact same concept. But the Prophet ﷺ did not say poetry is impermissible. Many of his companions were poets. In fact, Martin Lings, since we're in England, we should honor him, may Allah be pleased with him, a great English saint. He said that something we all know. He said Allah chose to reveal the final religion to a tribe of warrior poets. It's amazing. He could have revealed it to any people. They were all warriors and they were all poets. And they hung the best poems in the Kaaba because that was their sacred space, right? Even for them. And so this honoring the word, they had no other forms of art. Poetry was their art. The Prophet ﷺ did not say it's forbidden to do poetry. In fact, he encouraged his Sahabas, who were great poets, to use their poetry to duel. They used to battle. Like hip hop, we have battles, right? They would battle, tribes would battle. And he encouraged his you know, Hassan bin Thabit is the most famous, may Allah be pleased with him, but there was many other. Fakhruddin al-Razi lists over 100 poets amongst the Sahaba. And Aisha was a poet, poetess. Yeah, so women were poets amongst the Sahaba. And so this idea that purify and use it for good, you know, so that's something that was transformed. So this idea that as converts we're supposed to reject everything from our culture is not only problematic, it's not only problematic, it's impossible. Yes. You can't. Human beings, culture is the roots of a tree. If you cut the, and you see a lot of people that are trying so hard to adopt another culture when they adopt Islam, and they tend to be very imbalanced people. Even though if they're sincere and they're good and they're pious, it's very hard to maintain that. And you see people relapse and they go back to the, you know, totally go 180 and the whole thing. So, I mean, and one of the most powerful hadith which illustrates that respecting culture is a prophetic command, that you are not following the Prophet ﷺ correctly if you're not respecting cultures of all peoples, is that this amazing hadith where he said to Aisha, his wife, he said, if it weren't that your people were so new to Islam, and it's interesting, he said your people, even though they're his people as well, he said, if it weren't that your people were new to Islam, I would have reconstructed the Kaaba on its original foundation. Because the Kaaba had been changed, the dimensions. In the time of Abraham, it was actually a bit larger. And people that have made Hajj or Umrah know that when you can't go directly around the Kaaba, you have to do kind of a loop. Because if you go right around the Kaaba, you're actually still in the historical Kaaba. Because it was a bit larger. You see? So you have to go make a wider loop around. He said, if it weren't that your people were so new to Islam, I would have reconstructed the Kaaba. We're talking about the Kaaba. We're not talking about if somebody is a drummer or someone wears a pair of pants or someone has a different language or a different food or different dress. We're talking about the holy house of Allah on earth that all Muslims face and pray toward. And he was saying, because they're so new and because this Kaaba is central to their culture, in Jahiliya time, they all honored this house. If I were to change it, it would be too much for them culturally. They're too new. So what about if somebody decides to sing or somebody decides to play an instrument that, I mean, these type of things are just not even thought about. And the reality is when you get down to it, it's far more nuanced. You see? So, alhamdulillah, hopefully, that's something that we can
do. Do you think it's okay to do charity work for all religions?
Absolutely.
Oh, good.
This is...
Explain why.
Why do you ask?
That was my question.
Mm-hmm. My mum's a pastor. And I don't come from a religious background. She did that when she was older. It was something that she realised her religion as she got older in life. So I've been brought up in a non-religious house. And then all of a sudden my mum becomes a pastor and then I become a Muslim and I'm, well, we went through it all. I was a terrorist, I was everything. I wasn't even allowed in the house at all at first. But basically, my mum does a lot of charity work in Africa. She's always going over there and building churches and giving children the education that they need and paying for all that. And a lot of the fundraising that she does, I do with her. Mm-hmm. I help, I do like cooking things when they have evenings. Mm-hmm. And my husband's told me that because that's going towards Christianity, that I shouldn't be involved in it. Whereas I feel that any sort of charity work is charity work, no matter what religion it's for. So how do you
feel
about that? But what is the crux of why she's doing it? I mean, is she doing it to feed and educate and clothe?
I think it's,
or is
I think
it
it's 50-50.
Get souls for Christianity?
My mum's not the sort of person that would force a religion on somebody. But obviously, yes, she talks about her religion when she's over there. But she does it for her own self. I mean, she'd just gone over there recently and they took like 5 suitcases full of clothes that she'd made. We'd made all these dresses for all the children that have got no clothes. They've basically got nothing. And she took them over there. And yeah, she talks about her religion as well. You know, it's like with us, you know, any chance we get, we talk about it. Yes. But I don't think that's her main purpose. Her main purpose is to go over there and help. But obviously, because I'm part of the fundraising, my husband says, well, that's going towards Christianity and I shouldn't be involved in it. But I was just wondering how you felt about that.
Mashallah. I mean, I can offer some general principles in that, that, you know, our path is to do good. The Muslim is the one who people are safe from his tongue and his hand, meaning that you do no harm and you speak no harm. And in the other hand, you bring salam, right? Some of the commentators on why do we say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, to both directions. It's because it represents that you are a being who wishes peace to all beings for in the cosmos, right? And we are people that should unite with anyone for good and no one for evil, right? And we should unite with anyone for calling to righteousness and truth and beauty, and no one for calling to other than that, whether they be Muslim or Christian or Jew. Yeah, the idea is that, you know, we should be the people of service to all people and with no ulterior motives. We want good for them in this world and the next. And that's the prophetic way, you know. There's too much tribalism in religion and it's problematic, right? Too much Jew against Muslim, Muslim against Jew, Christian against, and then inter. But that's not from the prophetic sunnah, right? And when the Prophet ﷺ saw a funeral procession of a Jew passing by, he stood to honor this deceased person. And one of his companions asked, he said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of God, is that not a Jew? He said, not a Muslim, like why? And he said, is it not a human soul? So Allah in His infinite wisdom chose to create us with a vast diversity. And of course, you know, if you're not going to assist someone necessarily in calling to that which you don't yourself believe in or believe is good for them, but in to the extent that you can serve and feed and clothe and assist, you know, I think that's very good. Especially, you know, if your intention is just to ease the suffering of some of the children of Adam, you know. And we should be the people at the forefront. And alhamdulillah, Muslims are very generous, mashallah, very generous. And but we shouldn't, we should never think we should just be generous for Muslim causes. Or rather, we should never see that only serving Muslims is a Muslim cause. Serving all beings is a Muslim cause. And we should be at the forefront of protecting the environment, of protecting animals. The Prophet ﷺ forbade the killing, the cutting down of trees, even in times of warfare. It's not acceptable. The Prophet ﷺ, it's amazing in his time that he said this. In a time where he said, when you're making wudu, you should preserve water and not waste water, even if you're at a gushing river. But how can you waste water at a gushing river? The point is, this is a sacred thing. So, inshallah, we should be people that are a mercy for all creation.
I think his main concern was that we wasn't helping to spread Christianity.
Right. I feel you.
From that sort of opinion.
I feel you. And in that sense that, you know, for what you, you know, we should be the ones at the forefront of having our own efforts in this nature. And we should work with others to the extent that the outcome is good. So.
Do you believe that it's only Muslims that go to heaven?
Yeah. I think, like Sister said, it depends. I think that gets down to how you define what a Muslim is. What's that?
Mu'min. That's not
what's meant. Mu'min. Yeah, believer. Yeah. Believer. Hey.
So believing in God.
You know, the reality is that what we know of Allah is that He's infinitely merciful and infinitely just. And we know that in the Quran, it speaks about all the previous people of righteousness, people that served God and believed in God as Muslims, right? It's amazing, right?
Yeah.
And so our religion doesn't have the same issue in that sense as a religion like Christianity, where Christ is the central pivotal figure. You see what mm-hmm. I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so it's been very difficult. It's very difficult for all peoples in the modern world to deal with this question, because for most, in most places, at most times in history, you were in a closed religious universe. Everyone you knew was of the same religion as you, for the most part, at most points. And so there were just good people and bad people. There were righteous people and there were corrupt people. There were kind people and there were mean people. And it didn't have to do necessarily with religion. But in the modern world, we're thrown together, for better or worse, with people of all different religions and cultures. And then the dominant culture is like highly secular and even sometimes very looking down on the silliness of religion. And I mean, it seems that there's, if someone really looks deeply, as I have myself, at the core of all religions, you'll see profound beauty, profound truth, profound wisdom. That doesn't mean you have to agree with everything. But that's far less problematic for the Muslims, because we see that we accept the previous prophets and messengers and saints and wise men and women. We accept them all, and we say peace be upon them all. And we pray for them every day in our salat. So, and we know that we have a Furqan, we have our the prophetic sunnah, the prophetic way, as well as the Quran, as the Furqan, which is the discernment, the separator, the scale by which we judge. So Muslims historically never had a problem with taking wisdom and taking truth from the Greeks or from the Hindus or from the Africans or from anyone, and you know, making it, helping, having it flower within Islam. So, you know, the reality is that we say Allahu A'lam. There's always different levels of reality. This, it's basically not a easy question. I'm not like a theologian. So, but.
But personally.
Personally, it's very clear to me that it's not just people who are outwardly, I'm Muslim, I pray five times a day, this and that, are that they're going to heaven. I think on Yom Qiyamah, we're going to see that many people that we thought were Muslim, they're not.
Yeah.
And many people that we thought weren't Muslim, they are.
They are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I've heard this as well from many of my teachers, you know, and because, and like you, I mean, you see people with good hearts and sincerity and with love, and, you know, Imam Ghazali, who's one of the greatest scholars of our tradition, he said, there's people that accept Islam, they're Muslim. There's people that have never heard of Islam, they're forgiven. And they're judged according to what they know. There's people that reject Islam and they truly understand what it is, that it's righteousness before the Creator, that it's following truth, that it's honoring the prophets, that it's honoring your family, that it's honoring community, that it's wishing good for all people, that it's defending the poor and the weak. And there's people that honestly reject that. And those people are not Muslim, right? But he said in his time, which was 1,000 years ago, there's many people, and he even mentioned in Europe, he said, for instance, in Europe, who have heard about Islam, but they heard there was an imposter in the 7th century in Arabia who called to a new religion and he was a liar. And they reject him. They reject an imposter and a liar. He said, and the Prophet ﷺ was neither. So they don't reject the Prophet ﷺ. And in our time, so many people have misconceptions about Islam. On one hand, everyone, we have access to all this information. You know what I mean? You could read all about the life of the Prophet ﷺ like never before and all about Islam. And so on some hand, it's like there's no excuse not to know what this religion is and to have so many misconceptions. But at the same time, I mean, when you look at 9/11 and 7/7 and ISIS and, you know, women getting acid thrown on their face and the whole thing, like all these terrible, terrible things, there's a lot to sift through. You have to be a certain type of person to be able to see through all that. Mm-hmm. And so I think many people, even though they may live around Muslims and they may have access to the internet and all these things, they don't really understand what Islam is. And they haven't rejected Islam. You see, so it's our job. And the Muslims have not done a good job. We should look at ourselves. Have we really articulated, have we really expressed, have we really acted according to the prophetic way so that people say, oh, that's Islam. And I believe that the vast majority of people that I've met in my life all around the world, that if they truly experienced it and they truly understood it, that they have no problem rejecting the prophetic way. So may Allah help us.
What's your views on polygamy and obviously in this day and age kind of thing?
The easy question, huh?
A very easy question.
Trying to get me. No matter what
you
do, edit this part out.
No, don't.
SubhanAllah.
Well, don't forget you're in front of women here.
Yeah, I'm honored to be in front of women. You know, polygamy is more common than monogamy in human history. Polygamy is something that is found in many species, not just humans. And polygamy is a practice that is practiced by many human cultures and many prophetic individuals, including our Master Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So to act as if it's somehow worse than monogamy is problematic. And so I am a firm believer that people, there's many monogamous relationships which are beautiful. And there's many monogamous relationships which are hellish and which are torturous to one or both parties. Mm-hmm. And there's many polygamous relationships that are dark and which are oppressive and which harm men and women. And there's many polygamous relationships which are beautiful and within a sacred context. Something that Shaykh Abdul Hakim Arad, another great British scholar, said. He said, only the best and the worst men are polygamous. Because it's something very difficult, obviously, and you either do it for your nafs or you do it for a higher purpose. And in our tradition, it was always encouraged to marry the widows and those mm-hmm. who had no one to support them in that sense. And many of the Sahaba, which is amazing in our context, they actually married their best friends, their closest friends' wives when they died in battle, for instance, because it was like, I want to take care of her. Yeah. I want to honor my friend. It's not like, oh, I've been scheming on her this whole time. Now he's dead. It's on. Right? Now, in our cultural context, it's not normal. I mean, it is normal to have multiple partners, but it's just not normal to do that within the institution of marriage.
Yeah.
So, right. So, you know, I will say that I've seen individuals attempt to do it in the Western context, and I've seen in most instances that be an unbalanced and an unhealthy thing that ends up harming, you know, and a lot of it is just people are judgmental and, oh my God, and whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop, because it's not a normal thing. But it's another thing that if it's not part of your culture, it can be difficult to institute it and know how to do it and this type of thing. And if you're like living in a like Bedouin society where you're, it's much easier but now it's like so expensive to have a one woman and her and children with her, let alone a whole other family. So
circumstances.
More power to you if you can afford that. So, but my point is, you know, I can't give a ruling on that, but I can say we have to prioritize. And what's important is building communities, healthy, sacred communities. And if you're sneaking around and you're not honoring your spouse, it's supposed to be a sacred relationship where you draw nearer to the divine. And so if all parties are accepting, a monogamous relationship, then that's good. If they're accepting polygamous relationship, that's also something that's good and acceptable, but we have to prioritize what's important. And honoring our women is something that we are falling far short of, which is clear when you go in most sacred spaces in the Muslim community, where women are marginalized, to put it lightly. And that's not the way the Prophet's community was. There was no barrier between men and women in the Prophet's mosque.
I mean, that's one thing I think that reverts do have a big question over. Sorry, I think with reverts, it's a big question when, especially if you do marry a born Muslim man, you know, or from Arabia or, you know, an Arab guy, because, you know, in their cultural tradition, I suppose, in some areas of the world, they've, you know, it's been taken for granted that they will have more than one wife, you know, and when they come here and, you know, you fall in love and all the rest of it, you know, that is a question that niggles you a little bit.
Right.
And you think, well, you could actually go and marry somebody else, you know. Mm. And often, I think, these days especially, it's not done in a sacred way either. Mm-hmm. It's really abusive and it's really abused. And I think some men do actually lie and do it without asking their wives, you know. And that's almost like... I think you do.
This was my understanding. And, sorry. My understanding was that a man wishing to take a second or third or fourth wife should ask the existing wife's permission. But a brother of the Hanafi madhab told me, oh, not within Hanafi tradition. Is this true? Is there any madhab? Because I thought the Quran actually said no, that you have to ask your wife's permission. So
my understanding is just it's polite to ask, but not actually necessary to ask. So I don't know. So we've all got a different thoughts.
But also, the men should be treating the women equally as well.
Absolutely.
So it wouldn't matter.
Is that possible? Is it possible? Can you love two people of the opposite sex in such a relationship equally?
Yeah.
It seems to me like it's off with the old and on with the new.
Yeah.
It's not.
It's a difficult. It's a difficult thing. I mean, in men and women, it's a very fascinating topic, and I've thought a lot about it because, to be honest, to lower the waterline, it's very funny that most women that I've ever met in my life, the worst thing that they could imagine is their husband having another lover. And for most men that I've ever met in my life, the best thing that they could imagine is having multiple lovers. And I just think it's fascinating that Allah made it like that, right? Allah could have made it that women are like, I want you to have multiple wives, or I could, you know, and or men were like, no, I would never do that. I don't even desire it. I would never look at anyone but you. But it's not like that for the vast majority. And I think this biological urge, if you look at it biologically, is that for, you know, procreation is like spread your seed as a man, where a woman has she has a 9-month commitment plus the early years, and she wants her biological urge is a man that will stay put and protect her while she raises the children so she can pass on her genetic material. That's the biological thing. And we have a spiritual thing too, which is, you know, you should be in a sacred relationship. It's not just that you follow your urges, right? So, you know, but there was I read this book, which may be interesting.
In India, they have polyandry, don't they? And women have
yeah.
I don't know how many they're allowed, but I think they've all got to be from the same family.
Really?
I can't see them on that one from over there.
That's fascinating. Yeah, it's in a few cultures they do have that. I heard about this culture in like Central Asia, where actually there's no such thing as biological fatherhood. That what happens is a woman, when she comes of age, she gets her own room in a house and it's open to the courtyard, and she can have whoever she wants to come over and sleep at night, but the rule is he has to be gone by breakfast, by daybreak. And then no one knows who the biological fathers are, but her brothers play the father role for the children. So the brothers of the woman are actually fathers. So you don't father your own biological children. So there's many cultural manifestations.
Where is this?
It was in Central Asia. I don't know. I heard it in some. I came across it.
It's lovely.
I think it's Nepal.
Yeah. I mean, and
still now.
Yeah.
Olden days.
There's this individual named Wade Davis, and he studies a lot of like traditional tribal cultures, and he mentioned it as an anecdote. But if you there was another book that I read called Sex at Dawn, which studies animal sexuality as well as historical human sexuality, hunter-gatherers and the whole thing, so you may be interested. But one thing they mentioned, they also did a bunch of surveys with modern folks, and one of the things that they questioned women that had cheated on their husband and men that had cheated on their wives, and they found that almost all, without exception, women that cheated on their husbands said they were very unhappy in their relationship, they couldn't stand it. And on the contrary, men who had cheated on their wives, the majority of them actually said, I actually love my wife very much and I'm pleased with my relationship and I really... So for men and women, it's different. Like, you can disengage. It's not that but for women, I think it's difficult to even understand. Like, it's this betrayal, and I'm not... Yeah, a counselor, I'm not a scholar as well, so I'm just offering some.
How does a Sufi deal with the criticism from a Salafi?
Wow, that's a good question. How does a Sufi deal with the criticism from a Salafi? Subhanallah. We pray that we are Sufis and we pray that we are Salafis as well. We want to be on the path of the righteous predecessors, which is the Salafis, and we want to be on the path of those who are purified of the base desires and who have clothed themselves in selflessness and virtuosity and sincerity and mercy and love, and that's what a Sufi is. But, of course, not everyone sees it like that. So, you know, it's funny, there's an anecdote, it's a funny story. I heard about a teacher in Yemen, and you know, he is a Sufi scholar, Shaykh, and a bunch of Salafis surrounded his car and they were like chanting, and they were kind of Sufi, 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 and like, you know, kind of roughing up his car, and he was in his car and said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. We should all start, you know. And it's sad because Sufism is the aspect of our deen, right, that we know Islam is Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. Islam is right action. Iman is right understanding, right perspective, right belief. And Ihsan is right state of being. It's when you have the other two, right action and right understanding, that they culminate in right state, right being. And so the fact that you can't even talk about that aspect of the religion, how do we expect that our community is in a good state of being, or our spiritual spaces are in a good state of being? So the fact that we've taken Sufism out of our religion is, you know, the reason, one of the core reasons why we're in the state that we're in. That doesn't mean there's not excesses or imbalances in some Sufis, which, just like there's imbalances in some legal scholars and some theologians and you know, but the vast majority, Sufism is an inherit, it's the core, it's the heart of our way.
Why do we have to have different sects? I'm sorry, I'm new to all this, because when people say, oh, are you this, are you this, are you this, I say I'm a Muslim.
Yeah. That's sorry, what I say.
Push myself over. So where has this all come about? Why do we have to direct ourselves to one sort of...
Right. Well, like I said, Sufism was never a sect. And the proof is that there's Sunni Sufis and Shia Sufis.
Yeah.
It was always understood as Islam is not one-dimensional. Islam is Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. It's how to behave and act in the world. It's how to believe and how to understand your relationship with yourself and the cosmos and the Creator. And it's how to be in inner state, how your heart should be, how you should, what virtues you should cultivate, what type of awareness and what type of presence you should cultivate. So, again, not everyone sees it like that. And it's natural that in any human collectivity, there's going to be diversity. So we shouldn't think that it's a bad thing. It's a bad thing when we allow it to shatter us and not allow us to be united. But it's not about uniformity, it's about unity.
I find now that, I mean, I've been Muslim now for probably 9 years, and I'd heard of Sufism, and it was one of the chapters that I looked at really when I was learning about Islam, because everybody else said not very good things about it in terms of an Islamic context. Mm-hmm. But I'm a very spiritual person, and I came to Islam through learning about other cultures, Native American spirituality, so I was really spiritual anyway. Mm. But I wanted to worship the one God, which is what Islam enabled me to do, which is why I really came, as you said earlier, you know, a lot of people do it for that reason. And I've not really looked at Sufism as such on its own, but I do know a lot of people who would not follow the Sufi route for whatever reason and say that it's not prophetically right and, you know, there's things about it that aren't correct and, you know... And I find that hard to believe, with Islam being such a fantastic religion. You know, if it makes people feel free, and because it's freed me, having Islam in my life, and surely, why would Sufism be criticised? Because it's a spiritual path. Sufism is more spiritual than perhaps the other schools of thought, and there's nothing wrong with being spiritual. That's what it's all about, surely.
To be honest, I think, coming from where me and my mum live, it's the majority, well, we're probably the only Muslims in the village, to be honest, aren't we? But if I'm totally honest, I feel like I get judged more by Muslims than I do in my area, you know, because I don't wear the hijab and because...
I found that for a long
time. I do kind of feel that I do... Some people look at me as if to say, she's not Muslim, and I do kind of feel like I get judged a bit more.
I used to be very open about my background, same with the Muslim sisters, even if they were reversed, you know, that I've been. And then I realised I ought to really shut my mouth. People do judge, and it's a real shame. Because it's your journey, it's part of your journey, it shouldn't be ignored, you know. Why?
I didn't understand the different sects of Islam. And when we started Sisters in the Community, our first thing was no judgment. Mm. And then the other sister said to me, and whatever sect of Islam they come from or school of thought, they're welcome to all our gatherings. And I said, well, you know, I don't really know any of that, so we'll go with that rule as well. So I began to learn as the longer I'm in the community, all the different things. And I always said, to me, I'm Muslim, I'm not going to go to any sect of Islam. But I think naturally, the people that you turn to, the people that you like, you naturally progress to what, even if you don't mean intentionally, because you've got things in common and because it feels it's here.
Yeah.
So I don't have that label, but I know in my heart, they're the people that I spend my time with, they're the people that don't judge me, they support me, and that, and that's where my heart lies. Yeah.
See how much of a change it's made in me and how good it is for me.
For sure.
And they love to go and meet me in town. I've got one of my best friends is a tattoo artist, you know, that's like really haram in Islam, you know. But she loves to walk around with me in town, you know, we've both got our arms linked, I've got my hijab on and everything, she's all exposed, you know. But it's good because it shows people that, you know, not everything's Do you know what I mean? You can't pigeonhole. She walk with me, so sounds like that's not. And people judge me as well because I'm wearing Islamic clothes and she's not. She's so what?
Absolutely, that's. No, there's no. I know a lot of people that are quote unquote not Muslim who are way closer to following the Sunnah, even though they might not even know what that is.
Yes.
Than many Muslims I've met. So I mean, as far as you know, the important thing is that look, Islam is a path. You know, it's a path to God. Islam isn't the destination. God is the destination. And many Muslims have made an idol out of Islam, ironically. And if Islam is just a club that you're in or you're out of, then you start checking, are you in or out with your head scarf? Or are you in or you're out with your beard? Are you in or you're out with your pant leg? Are you in or you're out? You got the checklist. Are you in or you're out in our group? Or what is your aqidah? Or what is your tariqah? Or what is your whole thing? But then you're missing the point. You're not understanding that we're human beings on a path, on a journey. The whole deen, the sharia means a path. The tariqah means a way. The whole religion, you know. And Allah commanded us many times every day to say, ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, which is guide us unto the straight path. And if that was the truth, then why would, we're all Muslim. Every Muslim is commanded. If we were already there, then why do we have to be guided to the straight path? Because no, we're all a path of refinement. And the deen is like a hospital or like a psychiatric ward. And we're all a little bit crazy, right? Because we have our lower desires and we have our inconsistencies and our idiosyncrasies and we're trying to get more sane, right? We have an ideal normalcy. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the saints and the enlightened beings, that's normal. And we're striving to be like that. But it's a journey. And Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And Allah said, if there was a people that were perfect and never sinned, I would destroy them and I would create people that would fall short and forget and then turn back to me. That's the whole journey of creation. And so who do people think they are higher than Allah? That Allah, if Allah is merciful and they're not merciful. And the people that are judgmental and the people that, they're very far from the prophetic sunnah. Well, even if they have the whole look or they have the whole, you know, outfit, if they have the whole costume, well, that costume hasn't sunk in past their throat. Because if they're not people of mercy and compassion and love, they haven't understood the first step on the path. And so the outward is important, but we have to unite and love each other and support each other with what we agree with. And if we disagree and think, I don't think that's actually right, I'll still love you and I'll still support you because you have your journey. And even if it's clear, then I'll let you know, I don't really agree with that, but you're my brother, you're my sister, I'll support you as much as I agree with you and as much as I can because we all have our path. And that's what we really need.
On behalf of sisters in the community, I really want to give you a heartfelt thanks for the time you've spent and answering the questions. I think I can speak for myself, it's helped a lot and I'm sure it's helped the sisters
too.
So we really appreciate it.
Thank you for having us. It's been a great
It's a pleasure. We hope to be able to do so again sometime, inshallah, in the future. Yeah.
Thank you.
May your day be filled with love and light.
Amen.
May your wrongs be right. May your songs be tight.
Amen.
May your words give sight. May your nur shine bright.
Amen.
May you always be on the righteous side of the fight.
Amen.
May your lovers be loyal. May your soil be fertile.
Amen.
May your khakis stay creased. May your locks stay oiled.
Amen.
May your plans never get foiled.
Amen.
May your plot thicken.
Amen.
May your chicken be halal.
Amen.
May your style be sufficient.
Amen.
May your soul be free of its prison.
Amen.
May Allah increase you in your vision.
Amen.
May you find everything you've been missing.
Amen.
May you awake for prayer before the sun has risen.
Amen.
When you speak, may your audience listen.
Amen.
May you never feel trapped in the system.
Amen.
May you sire many righteous children
Amen.
Who will act on prophetic tradition.
Amen.
May you always have food on your plate. May you learn from every mistake. May you rise above all the hate. And may Allah increase you in your state. May you never pretend that you are what you ain't. May your friends be real and never be fake. May your rent never have to be late. And may your health always be great. May Allah forgive every sin, now and forever if you falter again. And may you always stay closer to your kin. And may he make all your enemies friends. May he make reality of your plans. May your present be pleasant. May you have a good end. May your heart be purified of its flaws. And may you act according to the laws that were revealed in the book of Allah. And may he catch you whenever you fall. May the one guide you to the truth. When you doubt, may he show you the proof. May you be like the Ahl al-Suf. With the wisdom of the elders, the energy of the youth. May he accept your prayers and your fasts, the very first all the way to the last, and remove obstacles that you have. And may you receive everything that you ask. May you never have regret for your past, and receive mercy, not the wrath. And as you travel down your personal path, may you always have a reason to laugh. Amen. Amen.